Hi, Teresa.
Hi, how are you?
I am just fine. It is so wonderful and exciting to be here. Teresa May, you are a NIADA artist, and how have you been having a great time this week?
You know, it's really wonderful when you're an artist and you can get together with people who sort of share your brand of crazy. You don't have to explain anything. You're just there to have a share fellowship and see what everybody else is doing and have a wonderful time with your friends. So that's it, what every NIADA conference is like for us.
Exactly. It's the sharing of knowledge and skill and artistry. One thing I have noticed with these wonderful artists is you guys are helping each other.
Of course. This is not an organization that's competitive, because we've already competed to get in, and so once you're here,
pressure's off.
It's really like family. I mean that sounds like a cliche, but honestly it's true. We look forward to seeing each other. We are in touch on Facebook and other media throughout the year, and it's important to be with people who understand the way your mind works. Mm-hmm. And we don't always find that in life. So
right. No, this is a wonderful place to be and people to be surrounded with. And you don't have to be an artist to come and enjoy this conference.
Not at all. I mean, we hope that the work that we do, regardless of what style that we choose or what materials that we use, the work that we do is relevant to people. And mm-hmm. whether it's to make them see the absurdity of things and laugh about it, or the fun in life, or to show them history, or to explore something current, we all put some emotion into our work, whether it's again, like I said, something silly and funny, or whether it's the pain of life.
Right.
All art expresses things that we're feeling, and the importance of it is to help other people feel it too.
Oh, I just love what you said. The message that you just said is so powerful, and anybody that buys, sells, creates, or has anything to do with dolls is going to resonate with that, because that's what dolls are. They're just culture and love and another way of traveling and a way to unite people.
I think that's true. And they, you know, throughout history, they've seemed to be so many different things. They started out as power objects and as very sacred things, and perhaps as fetishes or magic objects. And honestly, they still are.
They still are. Yeah.
All these years. They've changed form from time to time. They've been used as teaching tools. They've been used as tools to teach culture to younger people. But the artist's job is always to express something or mm-hmm. to show something and share that with other people.
And that doesn't change. So speaking of sharing with other people, this is the Button Thief. And she received so many questions and comments when she was on display on gallery opening night at the Grovian Doll Museum. What is her story?
Well, you know, I'm a theater person, so there's always a story behind what I do, or there's no doll. She's a person who is obsessed with buttons. The reason that I chose buttons to use is because a lot of people have given me buttons over the years, and their mothers or grandmothers, when they die, they all have a button tin. They're all full of mismatched or matched buttons, and it's impossible to throw those away.
It is.
You know, people have touched those. People have sewn those onto garments. They have literal history sort of encapsulated in them. And so it occurred to me also that obsession has nothing to do with the object that you're obsessed with. It simply has to do with the feeling of desire. So her desire is always for buttons. And she...
Let's look.
She has a hat that's made up of three buttons, a large one and two tiny ones. Her hair, or her bonnet, as you prefer, is also entirely
buttons.
Made up of buttons. She has lifted up her skirt to cross a mud puddle or to go somewhere, and she's revealed her secret at this point, because her underskirt is entirely covered with little buttons, and here is strings of buttons that have been torn off garments, so they still have their little fabric tags, little bits of fabric attached. Underneath the front ruffle is the really fancy buttons that she doesn't want anybody to see, because they'll immediately out her. Her pantaloons, which I can't quite get to, but they are covered with tiny buttons too. And then, of course, she's standing on this sort of cobblestone pile of dark buttons. she is a creature of opportunity, of course, so she always has to be prepared if she sees something that she must have. So she has a tiny secret pocket in her shawl that has scissors and thread and a couple of liberated buttons that she hasn't sewn onto her stash yet.
So fantastic. We absolutely love her. She tells such a story. She's a button thief, but you're rooting for her to steal more buttons.
You know, we've all been there.
Right.
We have. The other thing that I think about women is that our obsessions were often not very important, but we carry them on our bodies. We carry the weight of them. She's literally carrying the weight of her obsession on her body. So regardless of whether you just enjoy her as a nicely made piece of art or whether you understand that message in a personal way, it's there. It's not forced on you, but I put it in because I want people to feel something when they look at my work.
And exactly. And that is what art is when you look at it, it's supposed to elicit a feeling. And this doll certainly does. So speaking of your art, is this doll for sale?
Yes, it is.
So if somebody would like to purchase it, what is the best way? I did bring out your card right here.
I'm on Facebook, and that's probably the best way to get in touch with me. You can get in touch with me through the NIADA website, or I have email, MISSTERYMAY@yahoo.com.
MysteryMay@yahoo.com. Right. Thank you for sharing your button thief and for being here with us today and for this wonderful interview and everything that you said. We appreciate it so much.
Thank you.
Thank
My
you.
Pleasure.
Bye-bye.